Our eyes didn't do it for you.
That's a conversation for another time. But yeah. to save the phone bill here, let's get this sorted out. Richard from U2, baby. Bono is on the phone, ladies and gentlemen.
Woo!
Hi, Richard.
Good evening. How are you doing?
Not too bad. We're all happy here talking about the 80s, and obviously you must have a bit of a soft spot for that era in music, I would have thought.
You must have guessed my age already.
It's a certain age of people who can name all the songs and sing them all. So let me start by asking. Obviously, you play Bono in U2. You're the front man. You're the singer. Which era of U2 do you guys aim for? The kind of raw days of Warren Boy, or the later years?
Well, we play everything right up to the modern day. But I guess the thing that gives us the real buzz is recreating some of the early stuff. So. Right. When we got the call from Gillian to do 80s Fest, it was, really good news, because that's the kind of stuff we really like, the sort of punky days, the Out of Control and all those kind of tracks.
Well, see, I'm probably never going to get to go and see U2. I was always told, as I was growing up, that U2 were one of the best bands in the world to see live. It was the closest thing to kind of... Where the live performance and the studio performances were as close as possible. So, but I'm never going to get to see them. So I'm just going to throw it out there. When I was sort of like 15 and 16, I used to go to bed with my Walkman on, with a tape in, and I used to love the Under a Blood Red Sky live album. So any of the songs that are on that album, I'm going to love it, the sort of Sunday Bloody Sunday era. But I do like some of the later stuff as well. There was a great track called All Because of You.
Yeah,
which is a fabulous track that I don't get to play because it's not 1980s.
No, I think the thing we're spoiled with is the fact that U2 have such an amazing back catalogue.
Yeah.
You know, they've had their moments up and down through the years, but they've remained current. And so for us as a tribute band, we've got, hundreds of songs to pick from as opposed to 10 or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Gillian, have you worked with U2 maybe before?
I haven't, actually. I've spoken to them on the phone. And we've exchanged lots of emails, haven't we?
Yeah.
Copious.
We almost seem like virtual friends.
Exactly. Copious emails. In fact, I think the one I sent to you the other day started with the line, "Another damn email." but no, I haven't. But I've watched footage of them, and frankly, it was watching the footage of them that made me decide. I thought, wow, these are good. And I actually waved them in front of... Erica, there's three people who are the core of this, and that's me, Colin, and Erica, and then there's my husband floating in the background as well. But the three people who are doing the stepping up and the organising are mainly us three. And Erica is a massive U2 fan, and I waved U2 baby stuff at her, and she just went, yeah. And that was all she said.
That was all that was needed.
Yeah. So that was it. That as soon as I got Erica's nod, I thought, right, there we go. And I think you were actually the second band I asked. I got Rubik's in first because I knew them, and then you were the second band that I got on board.
The openers and the closers.
Yeah, exactly. Get your top and tail, and everything else goes in between. But I'm really looking forward to working with Richard and the rest of the band.
Can I just, let's just go round the table, and then we'll come back to Richard and get his answer on this. I'm going to throw out there my favourite U2 song. We had to pick one, probably New Year's Day. So, go on, Gillian, have you got a favourite?
Oh, gosh.
See, Colin's all right, so he's getting a chance to have a think about it now before...
Oh, I know it, exactly. I'm crystal clear on mine.
Oh, gosh, yeah, I'm really struggling here. I'm mentally tossing a coin, and it's Where the Streets Have No Name.
Right, OK. Colin?
It's one of the latest ones. One.
Well, that was number one as well, wasn't it?
I'm not sure if it did. I'm not sure about that, but... A good friend of mine is a lady of the cloth,
right?
And she was preparing a sermon, and she asked me for some input from U2, and she'd like to know if I had a copy of this record, and I didn't, and I was embarrassed to say I didn't. I got a massive record collection. Somehow this had gone by, crazy I know, but so I got a copy and I listened to it. Oh, and it's, I know Mary J. Blige has since redone it, and although Mary J.'s brilliant. U2, there's something in Bono's voice, there's an emotion there, and that song that just, some records makes the hairs on your head stand up, and the crown just makes that feeling of, ooh, goosebumpy. That does it to me every time.
So go on, Richard, what's the song that gets you go on stage and sing that gives you that feeling?
Well, I think you've just sorry, is that Colin that just
it is? Hi, Richard. Hi,
hi, Colin. Yeah, you've just hit the nail on the head there. I can't name a favourite song because, you know, first when we're performing, you know, the look's important. You know, the way it sounds is important, but actually we want to create the feeling of a U2 gig. So favourite song's really tricky to pick because they all develop that feeling in me, and if they do that for me, hopefully that goes across to the audience, and that's what we'll be trying to do at 80s Fest, is recreate that feeling of a live U2 gig.
I think then for Gillian, we need to, for your favourite song, we need to build a three-story pharmacy, get the lads up on top of it.
Exactly.
Get the chief of police to say, this is not happening today, we're closing this location down.
Yeah.
And then we just recreate the video for Where the Streets Have No Name.
Well, maybe I could maybe get someone from the rugby club to charge on, try and storm the stage partway through.
Can we not? It's a rugby club.
We can try and get quite close to Live Aid, I think.
We'll go for Live Aid, right?
We'll go for Live Aid, yeah, but without Bob Geldof swearing.
Can I be Bob Geldof
and
swear?
No, you can't. No.
I don't mind.
No, we're not having that, thank you.
Well, we quite... Hecky Thump, give us your money, everybody.
Yes.
Give us your flipping money.
Yeah.
it doesn't quite have the same gravitas.
I'm being very careful.
But I believe, Richard, there's going to be, without giving away too much detail, there's going to be a little surprise towards the end of your set as well, isn't there?
There is. I'm sworn to secrecy, but yeah, we've been working quite hard on something all I can say is quite special, shall we say.
There you go. So, no, for anyone who's listening that's going along, don't be thinking, I'm going to get out 10 minutes before the end so I can beat the traffic and stuff. You need to stay to the end of this one.
Oh, definitely. They need to stay to the end.
Can I also request that people bring your camera phones, sure, and you're going to want to record some of it. People do. I know, this happens. They're not supposed to, but they do. Can you make sure you've got some battery life for the last number of the night? Because we're going to ask you to turn your camera phones round and get those little lights on them. The little torches, you can put those on so we can do the stars at night thing, okay? Can we do that? What do you think, Richard? That'd be a good thing.
Sounds perfect, and I'm hoping it'll be dark enough by then.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. 10 o'clock, getting on towards 10, it'll be.
I was actually at the venue the other week it was just before, it was about 9:45. And you know when it goes dusk and it's just starting to fade, you get the light of dusk and then it just starts to turn over and it's got that kind of almost ethereal kind of greyy, purpley look to it. It was like that.
It's sort of fading to grey.
It's fading to grey very much. I see what Kevin did there.
Is there a theme here?
But no, so yeah, Richard, it's going to look good. It's and well, it's really going to... Yeah,
yeah. Having spoken to the team that are on sound and light this last week, this is going to be an amazing gig. I think you've already mentioned, you know, ticket prices that you can pay to go and see original bands, and ticket prices you go to festivals and things. The show Gillian is putting on, from what I've seen, as I said, talking to the lighting and sound crew, is going to be amazing. So, you know, if you haven't bought a ticket already, get yourself on the website.
I'm keeping my eyes out for Facebook and Twitter saying 15-hour wait to get into 80s Fest. So
well, it is down a little lane. The rugby club, there is a lane to it. So, and the lane we are going to actually have to cordon off because it gets too narrow to have traffic going either way. So if there's going to be a queue down there, people might, you know, they might have to.
If it's good enough for Glastonbury, it's good enough
for
80s Fest.
Well, exactly.
We're going to try and have. I've had a word with the man upstairs. It's going to be really nice weather.
Oh, you mean Dave in market management up on...
Dave. Hi, Dave. We've had a word, and it's the bad weather's getting out of the way now. So we're going to have the good weather then. Honestly, we have some positive thinking here. We're going to make it happen. It's going to be a gorgeous
day.
The
thing is...
No, you missed it. It's going to be a beautiful day.
Beautiful day.
Oh, see?
Playing over the stage.
See what Richard did there.
Very good, Richard.
to be fair, when you're a performer, it doesn't matter one way or the other because you're on a nicely covered stage. Someone will walk you from your changing room, or in this case, your changing tent, with an umbrella over you to make sure that no spots of rain spoil your makeup and your hair. So you don't have to worry about it. It's the poor buggers out in the crowd that is, like, you know, up to the knees in mud and still passing.
Well, by that time of night, the bear tent will have been open since 12 o'clock, so I suspect people will be in a very nice place.
That's it. Well, they won't even notice if it's raining.
Well, no, blanket on the ground. There's lots of food vendors and things. It's like Jamaican chicken. We've got bratwurst on a fire pit. We've got...
Noodles.
Noodles.
Japanese.
Noodles. They don't float my boat, but noodles. We have noodles.
I'm excited.
We have dim sum or something like that. Fish and chips.
I guess, Richard, are you guys going to be coming out signing autographs and posing for pictures with people?
Never one to miss an opportunity.
I have a feeling Colin's going to say that as well.
The wife's listening. No, never.
Then I think all that remains to do is, see, Killian's picked a U2 song to play to promote the fact that you guys are on there, which ironically is one that none of us have actually picked as being our favourites. I'm not sure why Gillian picked the one that she did.
What for my favourite? It was... I was put in a corner, and I had to make a snap decision. And literally, if you asked me to name my top one U2 song, there'd probably be about five or six there. So I just thought I'd put the first one out.
Well, the one that you've chosen for U2, baby, it's that one that has in the line "One morning, April 4th, shot rings out in the Memphis sky," which is, of course, it's all about the shooting of Martin Luther King.
Yeah.
Reverend Martin Luther King, saint, as it says in the song.
I've been there. I've seen the place, the hotel, the motel where he was, and you can actually go up. You can go into the room where he was, and you can go and stand level with the balcony. And I have to say, I found it quite. You can also go and you can part of the experience is you can go over to the place in the tenement on the other side, and they have the window open and the bathtub and the gun and everything, so you really put yourself in both places. But I was stood there, and I'll never forget it. It was a very, very powerful experience. There was an elderly coloured bloke stood at the side of me, and he was crying. Yeah. And I would have stayed there longer, but I thought, no, I'm just going to walk away and leave him. I thought, I'm not even going to attempt to speak to him, because this is a private moment for him. And it was quite amazing. And when you go there, you realise how powerful all that was.
Richard, that must be quite an emotional song to sing for you.
Yeah, I can't almost think of a song of U2's that isn't emotional to sing. I mean, I think you mentioned it already today that the way Bono writes is he kind of pulls things from the air and he has to be feeling it to get it out. And, you know, sometimes in the middle of singing some of the lyrics, you feel it. And sometimes I have trouble holding it together. But fortunately, on a song like Pride, you've got the whole crowd going for it. You know, U2 is filled with anthemic moments. And for a festival like 80s Fest, I can just see the songs we've got lined up for this. The time we've got, it's like anthem after anthem.
Yeah, I was going to say, there is no filler, is there? It's all big songs.
Absolutely, it's all the big songs. You'll know every single one of them. You know, we're going to have hopefully everybody singing along to every word.
I can't wait, and it's quite fitting that we should end this interview with that particular song. Rich, it's been great to speak to you. Can't wait to see you in a fortnight at 80s Fest.
Look forward to seeing you then. Thank you very much.
I'll be there singing along.
Excellent. See you then.
No problem. Thanks a lot, mate. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, Richard.